Yulia.
Thank you. Thank you, Krazia. And thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me to give this talk. It's clearly new experience in this current time. And I really enjoyed the first part of today. So I'm going to focus on the single cell. And I'm not just going to focus on the single cell, but I'm going to focus on the presynaptic button. Synaptic transmission will be my main focus. In many parts of central nervous system, these presynaptic boutons are quite small. So we're talking about 1 micron in diameter. And this imposes limitation on experimental methods. The photorealistic computational modeling of presynaptic terminals in general and the release machinery are essential tools that allow us to bypass the limitation of experimental approaches. And as you can see later, I'm not actually going to focus on the whole presynaptic terminal. I will be only focusing on the fusion machinery. So this is a brief overview of my presentation. So first of all, I will discuss biological background and highlight some motivation for this work. Also, I will introduce some phenomenological models in this field. And then I will introduce this novel mechanistic, so-called dual clamp model of synaptic vesicle fusion that we developed. So this work has been done in collaboration with Chris Norman. He's a PhD student at Warwick. And also with synaptic neurophysiologist Kirill Walensky from UCL. And biochemists Shyam and Jim Rothman from Yale. So first of all, I will remind quickly the main processes behind the synaptic fusion. So when the action potential invades the presynaptic terminal, we have the activation of voltage-gated calcium channels and the calcium, we observe the calcium influx into the terminal. Because of this presynaptic elevation of calcium, this calcium elevation will trigger vesicular exocytosis and the neurotransmitter will be released in the synaptic cleft. And clearly we know that after that, this neurotransmitter quickly diffuses to the postsynaptic site and the signal will be transmitted from presynaptic cell to the postsynaptic cell. So what I'm going to focus here actually on this part of the vesicular exocytosis. So we can see here that during this process, we will observe a number of synaptic vesicles filled with the neurotransmitters. These synaptic vesicles will be docked at the so-called active zone in the presynaptic terminal before this process of exocytosis will take place. So again, to shrink it down to the scale of the system I'm focusing on here, I'm focusing on the fusion machinery. So we have a synaptic vesicle here, and this fusion machinery, which will allow this particular vesicle filled with neurotransmitter to release these neurotransmitters in the synaptic cleft. So this will be the scale of the system I'm looking at. So what can we say here in terms of the synaptic fusion in general? So it is well established that synaptic vesicles fusion with plasma membrane is mediated by so-called SNEA proteins. And SNEAs can constitutively assemble into a stable complex when during this assembling state, these SNEAs bring opposite membranes together and provide the energy required for fusion. So what we will observe here that if we look at the presynaptic dynamics and we look at the presynaptic terminal, neuron transmitter release will be a very fast process. So this release will be at the scale of 1 millisecond. However, similar processes when we are talking about constitutive vesicular fusion, this process is much slower at the scale of 1 second. So one big question is, how can the fusion machinery operate 1,000 times faster at synapses? So before we go to the modeling part, let me provide more detail about what is known about the fusion machinery at the synaptic level. We have a synaptotagmin, which is a calcium release sensor. This synaptotagmin plays an important role in neurotransmitter release and this fusion process. So it is believed that at the rest, this synaptotagmin will clamp SNAA complexes. During the action potential, when we have a calcium elevation in the presynaptic terminal, this calcium binding can release this clamp and the fusion will take place. This is the general idea behind this process. However, this happens, how this happens still remains a mystery. What else do we know about the synaptotagmin in this process? So when calcium enters the presynaptic terminal and binds to the synaptotagmin, this will trigger membrane insertion of synaptotagmin in the cell membrane, and this believed to reverse the fusion clamp. There are two binding sites of the synaptotagmin, and it's believed the C2B domain is essential in this process. Also, if we look at the recent data from the crystal structure, we can see that up to two synaptotagmin molecules can bind to a single SNAA pin. And what is believed that there is a primary site which will bind synaptotagmin 1 at the SNAA pin, and there is also the tripartite site which can bind either synaptotagmin 1 or other isoform of synaptotagmin. For example, a key player here is synaptotagmin 7. And the main of this work is to develop a realistic model that will allow us to study calcium-driven vesicular release during physiological patterns of activity. So what we would like to use this model for, we would like to, to use this model to discriminate between different molecular mechanisms, because there are still many uncertainties how this process occurs. And also we would like to have this model with the predictive power. So we would like to have a mechanistic model so that we can actually study different mutations in the fusion machinery. And these mutations are known to be linked with the neurological disorders. So first of all, let me introduce what is known in terms of the phenomenological model. There are a few phenomenological models that have been widely used in the field. One of these models is the so-called five-site model. So here you can see that in this model, up to five calcium ions can bind to the sensor. Again, I would like to stress here that this model is phenomenological. So the vesicle simply has a sensor, which can, and calcium ions can bind to this sensor. So, and the release can occur only when all five calcium ions will bind to this sensor. And typically these type of models are developed not for the small synapses because it's very difficult to measure anything in the small central synapses, but these models are developed for the calyx of health, which are much more bigger. And then the data collected from the calyx of health, typically it will be peak release rate as a function of peak calcium, and then the model simply is fitted to the experimental data. So after this model has been introduced, another model that has been widely used is the so-called allosteric model. It's kind of a generalized version of that five-state model. So here we can see in the kinetic scheme that the fusion can happen from any states of the sensor, but clearly the fusion will happen with the higher release probability if all five calcium ions will bind to the sensor. And if we look at the five-site model, clearly the five-site model that I described in the previous slide cannot explain the release rate for the low calcium concentration, This elasticity model can describe the experimental data even for the low calcium concentration. So this model has been widely used, and I also used this model previously in some of my other studies. Also later, this so-called dual sensor model was introduced. You can see the kinetic scheme is much more advanced. And here we can see that there will be different state for the so-called synchronous and asynchronous release. I didn't mention it, but in case somebody might not know, synchronous release, it's a release straight after the action potential, typically in the window of 10 milliseconds. And however, the fusion can occur even in a longer time scale, and this release at the later time will be assigned as the asynchronous release. So here you can see in the dual sensor model, we can discriminate between synchronous and asynchronous release and explain the experimental data. Again, the data we used from the calyx of HELL, the large synapse. So here we would like to introduce the mechanistic model. We would like to introduce the synaptotagmin and the fact that when calcium ion binds to the synaptotagmin, it can insert into the membrane. So the initial scheme at the level of synaptotagmin is shown here. So synaptotagmin can bind up to two calcium ions. And when this takes place, this synaptotagmin can enter into the membrane with some rates K in. So this is the general scheme. And we can see we have a number of parameters here. And because we are looking for a predictive model, experimentally constrained model, clearly, first of all, we need to constrain these parameters. And again, it's not so easy because at the level of the synapse, not all parameters can be estimated reliably. So if we consider only K-in and K-on, sorry, and K-off rates, what is known that in solution, both synaptotagmin isoforms, so synaptotagmin 1 and 7, show similar calcium binding affinity. So this is in the present, in the absence of the lipid membrane. So we're looking at the kinetic scheme at this level. And also it's known that calcium binding to synaptotagmin is very fast and limited by diffusion. So if we take this fact into account and consider this KD parameter for both synaptotagmin 1 and synaptotagmin 7, we can then constrain the K-off variable. Now we have to look at the K-in and K-out rates. So again, if we look at the experimental data, what we know that both synaptotagmins will show different membrane dissociation kinetics. And when the experiments are conducted to measure this parameter, what it's done that it's really turned to be measuring some observed rate, as shown here as K observed, which make a transition from this membrane inserted state to the state S1 when we have only one calcium ion bind to the synaptotagmin. Also, we know that the process of loop insertion into the membrane, it's a fast process. So if we take this into account for the K-in parameter, and if we take this experimental data on the observed rate, K observed, we can actually constrain our K-out variable here. And as we can see here, the dissociation kinetics will be different. So we will observe different rates K-out for both synaptotagmin 1 and synaptotagmin 7. So one more thing that we need to consider before we construct this all ingredient for the single vesicle is the release rate. So fusion of synaptic vesicle with the presynaptic membrane is resisted by repulsive forces with the energy barrier E-naught. This energy barrier, again, was experimented, was estimated experimentally. Also, it has been estimated that each assembled snare complex provides delta E energy to overcome this barrier. So again, from the experimental estimates, we can know the value for this delta E. So here it's proposed to consider the rate at which N-free snare pins overcome the barrier, as described here by this Arrhenius equation. And we have additional parameter here, A. However, using the fact, again, from the experimental studies that the single snare pin can mediate fusion in vitro on a time scale of about 1 second, we can constrain this parameter A. So we can see here that we will have a function for the release rate, which will be a function of N free snare pins. So now if we look at the level of the single vesicle, again, we know the following, that the structural model suggests that it might be this magic number of 6 that is required to support the synaptic vesicle in this clump state. And later, new experimental data came using this Cry-AT technology, which again demonstrate that it's probably this magic number 6, 6 snare pins, they're holding this synaptic vesicle in a dog state and will lead to the release of neurotransmitters. So we took this on board, and now we'll put together all this mechanistic model. So we consider snare pin, and we consider there are two sites, primary sites and trapartite site. As I mentioned earlier, primary site can be occupied only by synaptotagmin 1, but the trapartite site can be occupied by synaptotagmin 1 or synaptotagmin 7. We have a release rate, which will be a function of unclamped snare pins. And also we assume that snare pins can fully zipper and then drive the fusion only when both clamps are released. So the clamps from the primary side and from the trapartite side. So this is a general mechanistic framework for our model. So now we would like to compare it against the experimental data. As I mentioned, it's difficult to get any data in the small central synapses. We have only the data from the calyx of HELD, and the allosteric model is a good model to describe this data. So our benchmark was just this allosteric model that was introduced earlier for comparison our results with this model. So here what we can see, we considered three limiting cases. And the first scenario we were interested in, which is typical for the experimental setup, is to consider different calcium transients in the form of the calcium step function. So here I'm showing some results for the step function for the particular calcium value. And the first limiting case is when we consider that only primary site is occupied, and this will be occupied with synaptotagmin 1. So here we can see that the dashed curves will be showing the results of the allosteric model from the calyx of HELD. Again, two different curves describing the data in the calyx of HELD from two different experimental laboratories. And there our mechanistic model with a single primary site demonstrate this blue result. Now, if we consider the case when both sites are occupied by synaptotagmin 1, so-called sit 1 scenario, so we will observe this decrease in the release rate as a function of time in our mechanistic model. However, we consider the scenario when we have sit 1 sit 7 combination, so the trapartite site is occupied with synaptotagmin 7, so we observe that the increase in the release rate. So if we summarize it in a single plot, typically for the experimental data, peak release rate is the concentration of calcium. So we observe the following. So in this first scenario, synapse antagonist 1 can describe sufficiently well the kinetic and calcium cooperativity. This is the blue curve. If we introduce SIT1 scenario, we actually observe a much steeper curve than the experimental data. But introducing back synaptotagmin 7 at the tripartite site will explain the experimental data very well in the calyx of health. Also, what is interesting, what we wanted to find out, what is the predicted number of SNAP pins that will be required for the fusion? And here again, we did some computation to check it. And what our model predicts is that three SNAP pins are driving vesicle fusion and physiological calcium concentration. And this is again a very good agreement with the experimental data, which is suggesting that to provide sufficient energy to maintain the millisecond rate of the synchronous release, three or four release SNAP pins are required. Also, we could observe this magic number three only in the presence of synaptotagmin 7 in the model. Again, this will indicate that synaptotagmin 7 plays a key role in this fusion dynamic. So far, I discussed the experimental data when we consider calcium transient as the calcium step function. Now I would like to briefly mention the process of short-term facilitation, because the idea of this model is to have some predictive power, and we would like to use it describing some mutation in future. So in terms of the short-term facilitation, typical protocol when the two action potentials are applied, and then the experimentalists are observing an increase in the release rate and the second action potential. Also, experimental data indicate that, say, if synaptotagmin is absent in the system, so short-term, this can suppress the short-term facilitation. Again, indicating the synaptotagmin 7 is important. And also, my collaborators, Kirill and Sham, introduced this molecular fusion model of cooperative activation, which suggests that the combination of SIT1 and SIT7 might be important of explaining this facilitation of the synchronous release, because both synaptotagmin 1 and synaptotagmin 7 will be operating at a different time scale. So the proposal of this molecular fusion model is that SIT1 combination will be important for the synchronous release, and the combination of SIT1 and SIT7 will be important for the asynchronous release, as well as for the facilitation at the second action potential. So taking this into account, we wanted to test our model when we apply two action potentials and we introduce the realistic calcium transient. So what we can see here in this framework, and because calcium transient will not be known from the experimental data, but again, in the previous work, we developed realistic three-dimensional models of calcium dynamics in the presynaptic terminal. So we simply took this calcium transient in the active zone near the synaptic vesicle, and we use this in our framework. So at the level of the first action potential, again, we have some calcium transient, and we can compute the release rate and the probability of release. And we can do the same at the second action potential. So now if we summarize this result, paired pulse ratio as a function of peak calcium concentration, we will observe what we wanted to see. So if we consider the situation SIT1, SIT7 in our framework, we can reproduce experimentally observed short-term facilitation. But we will not observe this facilitation for the seat one only limiting case or seat one situation. So here I would just like to summarize the main idea behind this modeling framework. So we introduced this mechanistic model, dual clump model, based on the known results from the experimental studies. What our model demonstrated that sit1 binding to the primary site is sufficient for explaining the kinetic and calcium cooperativity of synaptic vesicle fusion. We observe that if we have sit1 situation at both primary and tripartite site, we start to see some divergence from the experimental data. However, if we consider sit1 sit7 combination, this framework will explain the experimental data very well in the colleagues of health. And also the short-term facilitation can be explained well with this sit1 sit7 combination in our mechanistic modeling framework. So in future, we are planning to use this model to study more different mutation at the level of the synaptic machinery. And also we consider other possible scenarios at the level of the molecular dynamics here. So I would like to stop here and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Yulia, for very interesting and clear talk. We seem to have a question from Viktor Matveev. Not surprised. I was expecting that he's going to ask the first question. Yulia, great talk. Could you please clarify the very last step in your full mechanistic model? How is the last irreversible fusion step implemented exactly in terms of the ODE or reaction description given the 6 snare pin complexes?
No, this is all simulated stochastically. Not in a deterministic framework. So it's all stochastic simulation. We use a Gillespie model, Gillespie algorithm to simulate the model and simply probabilistic transition in the Markov chain type model. In this framework, we didn't consider the special cooperativity between the snare pins, but we are planning to do it in future.
Okay, there's another question. Can you also produce depression, not only facilitation with your model?
So far, my collaborators mostly were working on the excitatory synapses and we're focusing on the facilitation. Possibly, we haven't done it yet, but because we have this framework now, so we're planning to use it in more studies.
Yes, thanks. I have one question. Why do you think there are 6 snares when only 3 or 4 are sufficient for the secretion to happen?
Oh, it's difficult to say. Difficult to say from the biological evolution point of view. So it might be some kind of backup scenario. Plus, I mentioned this 2 population of snare pins, sit1 and sit1 sit7. So in some sense, there will be different number of pins in these different 2 populations. Plus, it might vary from synapse to synapse. This is something we would like to explore more in future, but I wouldn't able to add more about this magic number of 6 at this point.
Thank you very much. Thanks again, Yulia. I think it's now a good time to get our